So this morning's talks are going to be mostly geared to those who've never used OpenSees before. To those who have used OpenSees before, hopefully we'll show you a couple of little tricks that you might find useful. But for the first little thing, let's, on behalf of both Nees and Peer, we welcome you to this workshop. Nees, a long time ago, had a vision document for simulation, in which basically they said that we have to move our field from one that is based primarily on experimentation to one in which simulation plays a much more important role in the design of new structures. So that's the goal of Nees. That is my goal. I wish to improve simulation capabilities, primarily for earthquake engineering, but for engineers in general. That's the goal of OpenSees. Some observations on the current situation within simulation software. Basically, there's what's called a tight binding of models and the in the commercial codes. Researchers, they do their work, say, using the different simulation platforms. They can add their elements and materials into the code and make it run on their local machines. But this information is not getting shared by researchers to industry. The commercial companies, Abacus, they're picking up what's done in research by reading the papers. They're not actually getting the software from the researchers themselves. They're recoding the procedures and implementing that in their own finite element applications. And another thing, the problem with commercial codes, like the big ones were developed, started 20 or 30 years ago. There's a real tight binding between, there's a real coupling between how the code uses the hardware. They're all based in the von Neumann architecture, single processing unit, RAM, and a large disk. Things have changed greatly in the last 10, 15 years, and these codes are not able to adapt easily to these new generation of hardware. And finally, again, closed source is the norm. Researchers, if we find problems in the finite element codes, we don't know where the problem is. To find the problem, you have to, you know, delve into the source code to see what's going on. So for researchers, we actually like to get our hands dirty looking at the source code to see what's going on. That's something you cannot do with commercial code. So other application areas, they've all embraced the idea of open source software, where everybody gets to share the software, gets to look at the software, see what's going on, and make improvements in the software. Many hands make light work kind of idea. So that's where we're going. Building blocks for simulation. When I think of simulation software, I like to think of a bridge. To most engineers, or to most people using a bridge, all they see is the roadway. So all engineers typically see when they use simulation software, they're worried about what sort of models, what sort of materials and elements does this software have to allow me to do my my modeling and my simulation. To me, simulation software is much more than that. It also encompasses the numerical algorithms, the equation solvers, integration strategies that perform the simulation. And also on top of that, the other supporting thing is the information technology, visualization databases. That's all got to be incorporated in. Finally, our bridge, it's sitting on hardware. This hardware is changing dramatically. Every 10 years, Bell's Law, the computational system on which software runs, changes. It's been true for the last 50 years. Things have been changing. The platforms have been changing. So our software has got to be, our bridge has got to be able to take account the fact that the foundation is changing. And finally, the open source idea is we want to leave this bridge, we want to leave the structure open for everybody to have a look at, right? The beauty of the bridge is not just the roadway, it's the entire structure. So that's my sort of building blocks for a modern simulation. You want to expose everything to everybody. So quickly, what is OpenSees? OpenSees is actually not some application you download and run. OpenSees to me is a large framework for actually creating applications in the finite element domain. It's also a communication mechanism for exchanging ideas between researchers, for exchanging ideas between researchers and industry. Researchers, it's a mechanism for researchers to get your new developments out into industry. So OpenSees itself has been developed since 1997. Peer started it in 1997. It's a large group of developers and users. In the last 10 years, the actual application has been downloaded about 60,000 times. And if I show you where it's been downloaded, it's basically every country in the world, there's people downloading OpenSees. Nees has supported it since 2003. It's open source and royalty free. Basically, anybody can use it. What you cannot do is write an application that uses OpenSees and then sell that application to somebody. But if you want to use it in the design offices, you know, it's perfectly free to use. If you want to write an application that uses the OpenSees source code and sell it, you're actually able to obtain a license from the UC Patent Office. But, you know, only one company has ever tried to do that. Most people just, you know, commercial companies, they'll use OpenSees as the back end. So they'll include OpenSees application in their download package, and they just provide a pre and post processor to the OpenSees application itself. So for all intents and purposes, OpenSees is free for everybody to use and do what they want with. It's written in the C++ language, and there's currently over 1,000 classes in it. So our basic idea when we're setting up it, we wanted to be this as modular as possible. We wanted people to be able to plug and play with different things, try different ideas, whether not just materials and elements, which your typical finite element application allows you to play with. We wanted people to play with different solvers, integration strategies. So we tried to make it as modular as possible in our design. So you'll be seeing a lot of little diagrams like this from me today. But basically, we follow the notion of what are called design patterns, which is it's a widely used concept in computer science, where you recognize what different objects there are and what the patterns exist between the objects. And then what design patterns do is it shows you what the interface should be to the different classes. So as I say, it's very modular. So at OpenSees, we don't have what's called a static analysis or a transient analysis. Our static analysis objects are basically compositions or aggregations of a whole bunch of different objects. We're going to see these later today, and tomorrow I'll talk about how we'd put in a new object into the code. But just to say it, you know, it's not just the big ideas like the analysis or the domain. But even as we go down into the code, we've used this idea of modular and object composition wherever we could. For example, our beam elements, all the beam elements in OpenSees, they actually use what's called the basic system, this little system here on the bottom left. But the OpenSees, a typical analysis element will have what's called within the global system. So there's a transformation object required to move things from the global system to this local basic system. And by writing the elements in the basic system, we're able to plug in different geometric transformations and test new geometric transformations on any beam column element we have. Right now, we've just got three. There are other people playing with different geometric transformations to see, you know, is this something new? Is this something going to work? Again, at the beam column level, we discretize, we've got our basic system, we've got sections along the length, we've got materials at every section. So again, it's this idea of modularization, object composition, it's very powerful. As my old advisor used to say, form follows mechanics, stealing from the architectural Mies van der Rohe. So basically in OpenSees, we're following basically the mechanics of the problem. So what everybody hates about OpenSees is what's called the input, the interface to the application people will download. It's in a scripting language. It's called Tickle. And this is probably as complicated as what your input file might ever look like. But hopefully by the end of this morning, you'll be able to go back to this slide and understand what everything on this slide actually is, what the person is trying to do. Let me just tell you, right now she's running a parameter study with different frames and different ground motions in that file. So that's basically the input to run many different frames through many different ground motions. And as I say, that's probably as complicated as we'll get. So OpenSees is basically, we do finite element analysis, but there's lots of other parts in this code that we're not going to talk about. There's one presentation this afternoon which will talk about sort of the reliability part of OpenSees, which is a whole section in the code that we could debate a 2 or 3 day workshop to showing you how to use it. We don't, but just tell you it's there. Also the parallel and distributed processing we'll get to later on tomorrow on how to use it. But there's this whole bunch of other stuff that's in the code that we're not really going to touch about, but just to make you aware that it is there. Finally, a word on NEEShub, the Network for Earthquake Engineering Simulation, which is paying for the support of OpenSees. Basically, it's a network of 14 experimental facilities, and they're all tied together. All the data goes into what's called a central repository, and they provide tools for doing simulation. We're going to be actually using NEEShub later on this afternoon, hopefully. We'll be presenting it. And then the session at the end, where you do hands-on OpenSees stuff, later on today and early tomorrow morning, we're hoping to use NEEShub, OpenSees on NEEShub. So if you don't have an account yet on NEEShub, maybe at lunchtime you could apply for an account. And also I have to ask for the workspace, but we'll do that this afternoon. So on NEEShub, there's lots of tools. One's for the data management, you know, looking at the data from the experimentation. And the other one, we've got simulation tools. The simulation tool we're going to use this afternoon will be OpenSees Lab, which is basically all the OpenSees tools combined into one. So what are the objectives of this workshop? Well, basically, we want to show you how to basically do basic modeling with OpenSees. There's an awful lot more stuff in the code that we're going to talk about today and tomorrow. You'll learn about it as you wonder, how the hell do I model something? You know, what element can I use? I'm having problems with this solution algorithm. Are there other solution algorithms? So as you start using OpenSees, you'll start learning for yourselves what's there. My goal today is to get all those new users who've never used OpenSees at least comfortable running OpenSees, creating a little model, and performing the analysis of that model. We also want to show you basically the overall architecture behind OpenSees. It's important as you use OpenSees to actually know a little bit about the architecture. And for developers, graduate students who want to actually implement something in OpenSees, it's very important that you know how everything fits together. While you will concentrate on just your little element or material, it's a good idea to have how the whole thing kind of works. We're also going to introduce NEEShub, and hopefully we'll motivate you to use OpenSees for your own problems. So day one is, as I say, this morning is mostly for new users of OpenSees. This afternoon I'll start off with some nonlinear analysis. It'll be useful for probably most people here, talking about the analysis options in OpenSees. We're going to be looking at some of the different integration schemes with an emphasis on earthquake engineering, and show you we'll show you some things you probably really didn't know about Newmark method and other integration schemes. Then we've got some presentations from basic researchers doing work with OpenSees. Finally, in the afternoon, towards the evening, we're going to start showing you NEEShub and hands-on and how to use OpenSees on the hub. Tomorrow gets a little bit more complicated. We'll go into more in-depth structural modeling and geotechnical modeling. Then we're going to show developers how quickly how to add a new element or material into OpenSees. Finally, we're going to talk about parallel aspects of OpenSees, the part near and dear to my heart. To be honest with you, it's the whole reason I actually started writing the code that formed the basis of OpenSees was so that I could do my research in parallel processing. Then we're going to go, again, in the afternoon, we've got presentations, some from industry, people show how they're using OpenSees in industry, and then some researchers are going to show some additional work. So what should your expectations be of OpenSees? OpenSees is primarily used in research. The lack of user interface is an impediment to those in industry who want to use OpenSees. Graduate students, as I say, they learn to love OpenSees. They all hate it initially, but then as they start using it and they start playing with the features and its capabilities, they really like it. It's under continual development. As I say, I'm continuing to get new elements and materials, solvers, integration schemes in from graduate students doing their PhD work. Like typically, you know, PhDs will create a new element or new material. It's their dissertation. When they're done with that, they'll send me their element, and that element will get put into OpenSees. It's verified and validated by the PhD student. There's a lot more theory in their element than I could probably validate myself going through all the possibilities. So I rely on the graduate students or the professors who are implementing these materials and elements to validate and test them. The real sort of verification if this thing does these things actually work will actually be my users. We quickly find if something, you know, it works as it's supposed to. People use it, they'll have problems. Because these things are tested like against an experiment that they found or a couple of experiments, so they're really limited in their testing, these new elements and materials. It's when others start using them for situations where the professors never thought these things might be used, where we start realizing, you know, that this element it really works or this element has a problem. So that's, you know, what we can do with the verification and the validation. OpenSees is not bulletproof. There are bugs in the code. As I say, people who provide me with the code, they don't find the bugs. It's typically when it's used in situations that they never thought it was going to be used for, where we start finding the bugs. They'll start going into down paths that they never envisioned in when they're developing the code. It does take time and patience to learn OpenSees. And finally, the OpenSees community requires contributions to be successful. We need new elements and materials to develop to basically to come home, come back to mother, as they say. We can put them there. It's great for, you know, graduate students that you'll get their work sort of out. People will start to use it. Companies might get in contact with you. We'd like to use your element or material in our code. And it's not just the elements and materials we're looking for contributions for. Basically help answering questions on the message board. Those of you who've used OpenSees have probably seen the message board. You've probably noticed that it's either myself or Vesna or Sylvie who answers the questions. We would like others to help answering the questions if you can. It's what a community message board was really supposed to be all about. Ours has sort of gone to, let's wait for Frank, Sylvia, or Vesna to answer the question. We'd like you, if you know the answer, you know, post the answer yourselves. Special thanks to Heidi, Veronica, and Yolanda, and all the presenters.